My name is Bob Buckley. I'm a senior fellow at the New School in New York City, and my talk is Urbanization and Demography, the Coordination Problem. I guess this is a bit of an obscure title, and this first slide that I'm showing, I hope will explain what I'm getting at. And the slide is a photo of Mumbai during something called the Ganpati Festival, in which millions of people come down to the beach, Chaupati Beach, and they launch rafts with the statues of Ganpati on top of it. And it's coordinated quite effectively, and it's coordinated in one of the most interesting cities in the world, in a place that's very poor but very vibrant, and in many respects the cultural center of India. And so my point is to suggest that a lot of the development agenda today is looking at coordination problems, and coordination failures is something that should be emphasized by the new development agenda. And my point is that in that kind of sense of what it should be coordinated, the issue of urban policy has been overlooked. And so the question I want to pose is, how does urban policy fit into this new growth agenda, and what are some of the ways that it might be incorporated into that? And so my basic storyline has three narratives. First is the expansion of slums that we're seeing around the world, and particularly in the lower income countries and more specifically in Africa, something that is much more than social exclusion. Is it something that can really impede the way societies develop? And second, does the new development agenda overlook this and overlook it at a cost that may be such that it's making the agenda incomplete in very important ways? And then third, what is an approach to making urban policy work so that it's not so disruptive and so kind of neglected, and how do we approach this question so that we don't have the poor being essentially warehoused in very poor in cities that are dysfunctional? And so one of the stories I want to tell is, are cities becoming Malthusian? And to get at that, I want to get at the idea of who is Malthus and what are the notions that he developed? And so, and that, to take this over to cities. And so it's explained, I think, most effectively by a chart. And this chart shows per capita income over time for 2,000 years. And you see from essentially from the time of Christ to 1830 or so, that's a flat line. And what Malthus was referring to was that, in effect, if population growth without strip food growth, and you'd have a kind of steady state at a very low income level. And that's exactly how the world looked. And so what it suggests is that until industrialization and urbanization took place, that's the way the world was. And that world was one in which for thousands of years, people lived like this. And they lived in a situation in which the per capita income was about $3. About 50% of the women died in childbirth. And that superstition and a sense of this is how life is and it's unchanging, that characterized the world. And so suddenly the Malthusian cycle broke. And the question is, how did it break? And there's a discussion of, is it an industrial revolution? Was it a sudden series of innovations that got us there? Or was it a sense that there's a historian called Gregory Clark who suggests that, in fact, it wasn't inventions, but it was, in fact, the way people lived. And that in Britain, for one reason or another, the rich educated their children and they lived longer. And they, as a result, in a stagnant society that you have a basic steady state of population, more people were more intelligent, and that made them able to innovate and to, in fact, adopt the innovations of others. And so that this kind of human capital story is the underlying story of what made us break from this Malthusian cycle and start to grow. I guess the Malthusian city story is, are there cities now in the world in which we invert that, in which we don't have a larger share of the population that's living are better educated and more adaptable, but in fact they're less healthy, they're less educated, and they're concentrated in the slums of the urban south. And so let's consider some data to kind of think this through a bit. And the first data is one that many of you will have seen before, and it has to do with urbanization trends. And the green line represents urbanization, the red rural population. And you can see that we've intersected and we're taking off, and the rural population is declining as the world is becoming increasingly urban. And that the location of those urban population, the large green graph on the right-hand side, is the population increase that's going to be in the cities in developing countries. And as you can see, that's a massive amount. In fact, it's about on the order of 90% of the next 2 billion people will be coming to those cities. And to give you some sense of what those cities look like, let's take kind of a measles perspective on what's happened in cities around the world. And first, it's an image of cities of over 1 million in 1950. Then we go to 1975, and you can see the measles are spreading. And we go to 2015, and we've got a full-blown case of it, and there's lots of cities that are over a million. But besides that, another perspective is how big are these cities? And again, we're just going to take a couple of perspectives, but the bar chart gives you a sense of the size of the population 1950 as opposed to 2005. And you can see that South Asia, Latin America, China, these are massive cities, and they're cities of size that we've never seen before, and how do we deal with them? So just finally, in terms of this, to make this point very clear, the demographics are inexorable. These people are coming. They're coming to cities, and the massive size of it is just one image. Is the increase in India is bigger than the total U.S. population. So how do cities deal with this, and how did cities get away from this Malthusian cycle? Well, two ways, really. They can go up, and this was the first skyscraper, and it was essentially invented in about 1880. And so instead of having dense people living densely together on the ground next to each other, you could create buildings that could manage the density. And once you had the structures, and now we're building structures that are extraordinary size. But besides going up, you could also go out. And you needed transportation inventions and ways for people to get back and forth from their homes to where they work. And so both of those inventions took place after the urbanization took place. But prior to that, until those innovations took place, density was very deadly. And in fact, in the slums of low-income countries today, it still is deadly because they haven't been able to go up, and the poor have to live close to the venues where they work, and so they're densely populated and often very sick. And so this next slide gives us a sense of why this is important. And what this gives you a sense of is you can't have a country of even a moderate level of income that hasn't urbanized. What we see on this chart is per capita income on the horizontal axis, and on the vertical we have urbanization. And just the history of the world is such that unless you urbanize, you can't get out of traps of poverty. And so if we revisit Malthus today, we go back to this story of, instead of this increasingly educated, well-educated population, are we getting the opposite? Are we getting cities that you have people who have been trapped in these cities and slums that are less educated, less able to get jobs? And does this have an effect that goes beyond the social exclusion and in fact creates a situation in which it pulls down the society? So why does this occur? And this gets a sense of what's so different about today relative to the historical situation of urbanization over time. And there's three stories. One is urbanization is very different. And two, we develop cities in very different ways. And then lastly, the sense that the income levels of some of these people is quite a bit different than it was in earlier days. So first, urbanization is different. And how do we tell that story in a simple way? And the way I'd like to get at it is to compare the U.S. urbanization pattern. And as you can see, the chart on the top is income. The chart on the bottom, the graph on the bottom is urbanization. And what we're tracking here is the level of urbanization and the level of income. And going back to that earlier graph, you see that as the U.S. urbanized, so too did per capita income increase. We see the same thing today in China. It's a more compressed period, but you also have rising urbanization and rising income. But now what we want to consider is that the case today everywhere? Well, here's one country in which we invert those charts. And we see here we have urbanization increasing, but per capita income not increasing. And what you get are people being pushed out of the countryside to cities and disturbing the sense of a city giving you agglomeration economies, but in fact, perhaps giving diseconomies. And is this something that people are being pushed from the countryside rather than going to the bright lights of cities? And so we have urbanization is different, but so too is the way cities are developed. And the way they're developed now is often after the population comes to the cities rather than beforehand. And to get a sense of what I mean by that beforehand, this is what Rem Koolhaas referred to as the most ambitious social science prediction ever. And it's an 1811 plan for what New York City would look like. It took 90 years for that to be filled out. And that filling out was such that it created the city of New York, essentially. It also, a similar type of grid was developed in 1851 in Barcelona. And it's no accident that these are two of the more interesting cities in the world. If we compare those cities to cities in Africa today, we see public space in African cities has on the order of 10% of area that's free for public space to be used for transportation, whereas a very market-oriented city like Manhattan or New York has 35%. So those differences underlie an inability to use the space effectively, and how can that be done when you have people coming to the city before you plan for it? So we've got two of the issues. One, urbanization patterns are quite different. The planning and development of the cities is quite different. But the third issue, and one that's also important, is that a lot of countries, the per capita income is a lot lower than it was when today's industrialized countries urbanized. And this gives a sense, corresponding to that, the light gray area is what's happening to urban population. The other two charts, the blue and the green, have to do with urban and rural. The top is rural, and the bottom is urban. And we see that the supply of urban services are not keeping up a population, and we see that, in fact, cities in the developing countries are falling further behind in basic infrastructure services. And so that the result of this is, instead of cities like these, the well-known image of Chicago or Paris, or I think that's Shanghai, we have cities like this. And this is a photo of Kibera and outside of Cape Town. And we see that we have what in many places are cities that are filled with 75% of the population in dysfunctional cities. So what can be done about this? And what are the issues that can break this sense of what I'm terming Malthusian cities? And I'd say the answer is on two levels. One is conceptual, and the other is some practical steps. So on the conceptual one, we need to rethink how we think about cities. And cities in the developing world have become, in places, homes of desperation for millions of people. They can't leave their country. They flee from the countryside, and they're trapped in cities. And so the accepted development agenda, the idea of looking at what are the binding constraints to growth. It's a very big step forward from the kind of rigid Washington consensus. But within that agenda, there's not very little consideration of coordination problems in cities. And so donors should recognize that stories such as Lions on the Move that have been made about people in Africa, it won't take place with the dysfunctional cities underlying. I mean, they also have to recognize that the city plays a big role. And so in part of this is that there needs to be a recognition that a business as usual perspective simply won't work. The numbers are too big, the processes are already dysfunctional, and they're likely to get worse unless change is made, and that change has to be fairly significant. So fortunately, there's lots of new technologies that can help with this, but those new technologies can only be effective if people want to use them and understand how important it is to use them. And finally, within that, we have to recognize that a lot of these people are very poor, and so they're going to require subsidies, and new ways of targeting subsidies on the poor have to be applied, because simply the numbers are far too great to try to subsidize them without targeting it effectively. So to close, the story I'm telling is really one that's very old, and it's one that I'm particularly fond of Jane Jacobs' interpretation of the role of city in the economy. And this quote, I think, really applies, and the quote is that cities, not countries, are the constituent elements of a developing country and have been since the dawn of civilization. What I would add to that is that our civilization today is going through some very different stories, and we have to understand those, and that while the problems are quite manageable, unless we address how important cities are and how different the circumstances are, we won't be able to catch up with the issue, and it'll be very unfortunate. So with that, thank you.